You want to start with an intro?
I'm in. Okay. Welcome, everybody, to the Firewall Talk. My name is German Eichberger from HP Helion, soon to be known as HPE.
I am Vishwanath Jayaraman from Brocade.
And I'm Sridhar from Cisco, been working on FWaaS for a while now. Anyway, so let's get things started. I think a couple of things that we wanted to really do is that I think first off to say, you know, why are we here today? FWaaS, as you know, some of you who are following it know, was started in Havana, and you know, from that point, things, there have been some changes, but at some point, I think possibly as we had came out of the summit in Vancouver, you know, there were some concerns that were expressed in terms of the API, the applicability of it, you know, and then it was probably in August when Kyle, the then PTL of Neutron, called a few of us and said, hey, you know, I mean, we are serious about FWaaS, and we really wanted to jumpstart this and get this going, and let's kind of take a fresh look at requirements. Let's see what we need to change, and you know, get that moving. And that's kind of where we you know, landed up over here. And you know, and as a team, I mean, we are kind of a collection of people with different affiliations. You know, I mean, in some sense, the contributors are mostly vendors in some form. You know, we do have, you know, German is from HP. We have some kind of operators. And I think today what we really want to do is that we want to kind of get a feel of, you know, give you guys a feel of where we are, where we are going, and we really want to encourage some, you know, conversation with, you know, users to make sure that whatever we are doing with this restart, you know, we are building something that, you know, with user input, and we land up in a good place, you know, finally, you know, over, you know, next couple releases. So that's kind of the, you know, motivation. And for today, really what we are covering is, yes, there is no, I mean, this is not a talk where we come and tell you that we have done these things and there is no demo that we have to give. I mean, we're kind of, you know, starting things off. Doesn't mean that we're throwing away the existing code, but we're trying to adapt that to see what, you know, we need to change in terms of the API. And, you know, that's kind of, and then lay out sort of a roadmap as to where we are going. So that's kind of the, you know, outline for what we want to present today. And where FWaaS is, you know, today, essentially what FWaaS is doing is that it supports north-south perimeter firewalling. And we have issues with DVR interactions on east-west, you know, flows. And so this is one issue that we have. And the other thing is that FWaaS, when it started off, it didn't really have a place where you associate, you know, a firewall. The firewall was associated with the tenant and essentially was applied to all routers in the tenant. And from that, over Kilo, we moved that along, you know, to a model wherein it is associated with a specific router list. And in talking more and thinking more about this, you know, it seems that, you know, it's more applicable maybe at a router interface level than putting it on a router. That seems a bit too nebulous. So that's definitely one of the issues that we have been seeing. And even as we added support for the router, we always had that mentality that maybe we do need to keep the port, you know, as an option, and which seems to make more sense than putting it on a router. And the other, you know, big drawback is that, you know, FWaaS is kind of very router specific. Even if we did bring it out, you know, and say let's put it on the ports, it's essentially very router specific. And we are getting a lot of interest and people talking to us and saying that, hey, how do we solve the VM to VM traffic firewalling use cases? And so that's something that we really, you know, there is a lot of interest in that. And then that immediately kind of leads to, okay, so now what is the intersect with, you know, security groups, and, you know, what is security groups, what is FWaaS? And I mean, some of the discussions has been that with security groups, I mean, it's an established API, and there is some reticence to kind of go out and change that API for, you know, compatibility reasons with, you know, AWS migration and things like that. So in some sense, we are kind of hitting a little bit of muddy waters in terms of how we coalesce these things, you know, to exist together. But this is one of the things that we want to go after right now. And the other thing is with service chains, containers. There is a lot of interest, especially for vendor firewalls, to plug in. I mean, today there isn't, while as vendors we do support our firewalls, but there isn't a fantastic way to plug in kind of an appliance. I mean, and that's something that, with the evolution of service chains, and that's something that we also want to get to. So the big thing right now, as I kind of alluded to, is the evolution of the API. And, I mean, right now we are kind of throwing some ideas around to see what the API should look like. Things that kind of, what we really see is that we see this need to go to a port-based model as opposed to a router-based model. And when we say port-based, we also want to make it more generic so that we are not kind of, very router-centric. We wanted to, address the VM use cases as well. So this is, one of the major things that we are working on. And the other aspect kind of related here is that, in terms of, roles, and how you deploy firewalls. And, in a tenant environment, you may have someone like a tenant admin that might want to enforce a particular, firewall policy or, that is enforced tenant-wide. And there might be users, kind of like the security group model where, app guys may want to put in their own firewalls, and how do you kind of coexist these things? So this is another aspect that's kind of, we are trying to see what we can capture onto the API. And, the other generic things is like, how do we do some kind of grouping mechanisms? We had a blueprint out way back where we talked about address groups. Now, if you want to think in terms of from grouping mechanisms that you can use in rules, as well as grouping mechanisms that you might say where you apply a firewall. A firewall is applied on a set of ports. A firewall is applied on all VM ports on a tenant. So we are kind of looking at some of these kind of grouping mechanisms in terms of how you apply the firewall. And then the other thing is how do we interplay with the security groups? And this is going to be like a big discussion in terms of how we actually affect that. German is going to kind of lay out some of the plans and how we move forward with some of those aspects. The other area where things were broken was on east-west firewalling with DVR. We have had discussions with the DVR folks, and I mean there are some ideas around that, but this is not a very straightforward, simple problem to solve because DVR kind of introduces an asymmetric, model with respect to routing, and FWaaS inherently because of connection tracking, we kind of have to see where you apply the firewall. You have to see both sides of the traffic, and DVR kind of breaks that assumption. So there are ways to solve this, and now what is the optimal way to solve it? And maybe as we move towards a VM port model, maybe this is less of a problem. So that's some of the things that we are thinking about as well. So yes, we are trying to kind of, go through the API, and come up with this. What would be ideal is to say that, oh yes, we've kind of gone through this whole API model and here is this, complete, lay of the land and what the API looks like. And then we start working on it. But really what we are saying is that, that's probably, in terms of velocity, that's probably going to hurt us. So the approach that we are taking is that we are working to getting, crystallization on the API as a long-term objective. And as some things, fall out and we have clarity, we want to kind of attack those things in the M cycle itself. So, I mean, the router interfaces, I think we seem to be kind of fairly unanimous on that aspect. The VM ports, yes, I think we absolutely want to do it. There are some challenges with VM ports, especially with how you interplay with security groups. We do want to see if we can pull that in for, with respect to Mitaka. And, service groups is another notion wherein you kind of group, you have a grouping mechanism for protocol and ports so that on a rule, on a specific endpoint, you could specify a whole bunch of, protocol or port kind of grouping. So this is something that's happened in the past. I mean, the reviews have been out for a while, so maybe we might pull this in. And then zones is another thing that's a long ask for as a basic firewall feature. Let me hand it off to Vish to talk more about that.
Yeah. So what I'm going to talk about is in zones is actually just give you guys an overview. It's not about what we're going to be implementing. This is probably what it'll look like. But I just want to introduce the concept of zone-based firewalls that we think will implement in the upcoming cycle. So in general, most of you must be aware that ordinary firewalls, when applied to a it's a rule set applied on a per interface basis, which means any traffic coming to the interface, you actually do some packet filtering at that point of time. So we want to take it to the next level wherein you can actually group interfaces so that those interfaces become part of where the same security policy is applied to those group of interfaces, which will be the zone. And they will all share the same security zone. So here, the packet filtering will be applied at the zone or the group of interfaces level. That is what a zone firewall would be. And any traffic flowing between the same interfaces as part of the zone, there won't be any filtering happening there. So that gives you, in a nutshell, what a zone-based firewall would do. Additionally, next slide. There are other things, key things as well, some criteria, but we may not get to everything. This is, again, just introducing the concept and saying what could be part of the upcoming release. So other key features, other key things you might want to be aware of in a zone-based firewall is that, well, any traffic coming into the router and going out of the router may not be filtered, right? That's the other thing. And other constraints would be that if you have an interface that's part of a zone, it cannot be part of another zone, so it can only be part of one single zone. And if you actually have any interfaces that are not part of any zone, and if you don't have any rules that apply to the interface, any traffic can flow unfiltered. And any traffic between interfaces within the same zone will be unfiltered. So this is the kind of thing we want to introduce and sort of think about how we apply in the upcoming release. So this is one thing we are identifying, but there are other things also we are looking for in tactically, and also that's where German is actually going to go through what we can do tactically and what we also have a long-term roadmap. I'll hand it over to German.
Okay, thanks. Okay, so for in the next cycle, let me target a couple of generic cleanup things that are needed, so to basically deal with current pain points. So the L3 agent, how a firewall is going into, is pretty messy, so we need to fix that and add it to the observer hierarchy to have a much more cleaner insertion, so just to move forward. The other thing is the test coverage. So tests have been changed in Neutron, and we basically need to move our tests in tree now, and as we want to increase our test coverage, basically to get earlier with the bugs and everything. And right now, our automatic tests are not very good, so we need to set up an automatic gate, so every time we check something in, it gets basically tested. So the whole testing thing needs a lot of improvement. Now, I want to talk what we did during the Liberty cycle. So we got together in Seattle for a mid-cycle, and we encouraged the community beforehand, so when we were in Vancouver, said, let's collect all the use cases, all your requirements, what you expect from firewalls, and also what you expect from security groups, so we can basically understand what does the community want out of this API, and what makes sense to move it forward. So we basically collected all of them, and then we sorted them into a Trello board, and basically we looked what is covered by the security group API, what is covered by the existing firewall API, and then we identify the gaps, what needs to be added to the firewall API if we would leave it today, how would it need to be evolved to basically to have all the things the user wants. And there were also gaps which were both in the security group API and the firewall API. And then we decided a few things which we felt were out of scope for either the firewall API or the security group API, because they were just not something we felt should be done there. And then there were things which said, okay, it won't fix you. Because always happens to stuff we felt we shouldn't even cover at all. Out of scope means more we might want to do it in the future and won't fix, probably it's more in the thing of never. And then we basically flagged them all and sorted them all, which is a good guiding for us when we now go and develop a new API and develop improvements. Then we have all those requirements and can see, run them against our API. Can you actually do those things with this API we are proposing?
Next.
That's the next slide. So this is a rough component design. Probably will look different when it's realized. But one thing we learned early on when we started working on it is the security group API is loved. People really want to retain that. We can't really deprecate it. And so what we are trying to do is we are trying to do this kind of dual thing. We want to have the security group API. We want to have our new API, the firewall as a service API, rebooted with lots of new features. But we want them all go to the same back end, so there's one source of truth. Because the current thing which annoys me as a developer is I might open a port on security group API, but it still doesn't work because somewhere in the firewall API, somebody blocked that. And so what I really, really want is this one backend where people then, one source of truth, so I can see in both APIs what's being blocked and what's available. Of course, so basically if you're a fan of security group API, nothing will change, you can use it like you do today. Will all be the same. But if you then start touching a rule you might have created in a security group API with the more enhanced API, then of course you will basically then switch to read only and you can't touch it again because the other one has much more features that are not replicated there. And so over time we hope that people will migrate over to the new API, but that's one of our hopes. On the other things at the bottom, well, another thing we learned is the firewall space is just a very small picture, a small piece of a much bigger security puzzle. And we need to be very adaptable, very pluggable to basically allow for those complex scenarios people might want to do. So you want to have a firewall insertion plugin because you might want to use IP tables to put it in as our thing. And a firewall insertion plugin, you might want to use a service chain to do that, or might be another way to do it with OVN or OVS or whatever you have there. Packet capture is something which got a lot of asked by people, locking out packages and then maybe shipping that to analysis software which looks for anomalies in your network traffic and then makes decisions. So you want to enable that, or maybe tap into a tab as a service, but make it pluggable so we can plug in whatever makes sense there. And the hard piece of a firewall is packet filtering. We also want to make that pluggable because you might want to use the IP tables. We probably go for reference implementation, but you might want to do an SDN thing to drop things like we have seen that thing in OVS, they now have security groups implemented there. So we want to make it pluggable and flexible enough that all those things can be covered with our design. So the other thing what we did in Liberty, we basically deprecated the firewall as a service API. It has been experimental for a while and never gained enough traction. The people didn't really use it the way it was supposed to. And so we decided to kind of deprecate it so we can move on. It doesn't mean that it's going away immediately. So we don't have a new API, so we don't want people to be without firewalls in Liberty and so basically, it's not going away immediately, but we want to make sure that everybody understands you shouldn't bet your farm on that. You shouldn't make now the biggest firewall plugin ever for it, or make the biggest automation ever for it because it's going away. What's important for us, and I learned it the hard way. We did load balancing V1 to V2, and we didn't do any backward compatibility. We learned it the hard way that it's not how it's supposed to work. And I'm saying the API, we might not be backward compatible, but we need to include vendors. So it's not always that vendors want to make the step from the current drivers to the new API. And so we need to make sure that we kind of are backward compatible enough that the driver, which right now works in the old firewall API, continues to work in whatever we develop, either by getting those vendors engaged, that they kind of adapt their drivers, or that we kind of add to the compatibility layers so we can basically run the old drivers, might not have the full functionality, but it still works so customers or operators or users invested in those appliances. They are not suddenly discovering if you upgrade to Mitaga or N or whatever, you can throw this device away. We don't want that. So we came up with a roadmap, and we want to enhance the test coverage. It's very important. And the reason we want to do that is we want to do test-driven development for API redesign. So as we develop the new API, we want to develop the tests to basically immediately test that. And when we look at our API redesign, we absolutely want to go port-based. And basically, I interpret that as a Neutron port, because everything is going to Neutron ports. Service chaining is connecting Neutron ports. We have Courier, which exposes containers as a Neutron port. So this is, I think, the right integration point for the firewall to integrate into Neutron. The other thing we want to do, we want to augment security groups. So the people who want to try us out, and right now, today, use security groups, they can go over and have similar or the same functionality, or maybe even more. So it's worthwhile for them. We want to make an IP tables-based reference implementation, because without a reference implementation, you can't really do anything in OpenStack. And we also want to work on service groups, which is a grouping mechanism. Grouping is very important to make it easier for users. We don't want them to write millions of source destination. We want them to have higher level constructs than that. So that's our goal for Mitaga. And depending on how many people we work on, then we might get it done, less done, maybe more done, never know. But going further on, in N, we want to improve our reference implementations. So going port-based introduces one important question. So right now we had routers, and people have far less routers than they have ports in their installations. So going port, we will basically need to get better scalability. We need to basically figure out ways to more efficiently push updates to our firewall, because we have now much, much more insertion points we have to update, we have to manipulate. And so scalability is a topic then for N to make it actually work for bigger clouds, not just DevStack. And then HA, that can be really used, figure out how we can do HA. The other important thing which talked about is zones. We'd love to have them much, much earlier, but one fear we have, we really want to get the API out in M, in Mitaga, so we put zones into N, but if we have enough room in Mitaga that things go even faster than we thought, or we have more contributors, and there's lots of excitement, so we talked to a lot of people, and it seems engineers are coming from everywhere to help us, so maybe zones are making it into Mitaga, but we are hoping have them for sure in N. Then for O, we want to integrate with a lot of things which are currently developed in the community. There's the service function chaining. So we think it will be mature enough in O that we can fully integrate with that and kind of leverage them for our service insertions and also be a part of their use cases. Because when you look at their presentations, there's always the word firewall in there. And so we want to be that firewall. So we want to do that in O. Other exciting thing happening in the community is the common classifiers. We want to leverage them, want to be compatible with them. We think they will be mature enough that we can integrate with them. And the other thing we want to have finished there is the common backend for security groups and firewalls. That doesn't mean that we haven't developed it yet, but our goal is that in O that we have shown enough development, we have shown enough functionality, we have proven it ourselves enough that basically in the O release that we will be there right in the box with firewall as a service. And have the common backend as basically the backwards compatibility for the security groups. Because what's happening is security groups are right in the box, whereas people have to install us as an extra. And we hope when by O we have proven enough that we can convince people to put us in the box and then kind of become the default way of doing this security, firewallish security in OpenStack. And of course, by then we will have lots of tech debt we have to pay off. Okay, let me talk about how you can help. So we have a channel called OpenStack Firewall as a Service where we all congregate and join that channel, say hello, and then we will say hello back. And so you can start contributing. The other thing we have is we have weekly IRC meetings. Right now, they are Wednesdays on 1830 UTC for the North American Europe bunch. And then we have one on first days at 0 UTC where we encourage Asia Pacific. But we probably gonna change that a bit because we kind of picked up a bunch of people out of Bangalore and that's not convenient for them. So that might change, but right now that's where we are. And we always try to publish the agenda so people know what they expect. Yeah, another great way for you to contribute is if you see that something is missing or we made a mistake, then you can file a bug on RFE for your idea, and you can add it to your agenda and you can talk to it. And so then we can collect that and then sort of project manage that in Launchpad. And if you get serious about helping us, then you need to sign the contributors license agreement or whatever else will replace it. And then you can start helping us in Garrett, can code review. We are always looking for code reviewers. And that's actually the best way to get started in OpenStack is reviewing code to see how things are programmed, how things are written. And so yeah, lots of code reviewing. Can write code, it's a good thing, we like that. Can write documentation. Documentation is very important for us. So some projects more so like an afterthought, but we want to really have good documentation because we really count on that this thing has a wide adoption. If you don't document it right, people won't know how to use it, and then they won't use it. So documentation is really the corner piece of our strategy is get people use it, and so we need documentation. And of course, you can help if people ask questions in the IRC channel, know the answer, be sure to jump in. And the other thing we want to do is we want to do a mid-cycle. It's very likely sometime in January, February next year in Seattle. So if you like Seattle, you should plan on coming. And yeah, invite everybody. Questions?
IP tables reference model. I have a question. Different update in the reference implementation supported.
Say again.
Is there supported of different update IP tables?
Another implementation, like something like IP sets. Oh. Is that, something other, like a backend other than IP tables? Is that your question? I'm not.
IPv6 and IPv4, IP tables.
We do IPv6 and IPv4.
Yeah, we do support v6, yeah, even today. Yeah, you do support V6.
Yeah.
One question out of curiosity. Both IP table and OVS have the capability to act upon marked traffic. Mm-hmm. And, so these underlying technology have some faithfulness in their flow tables.
So marking is probably a little bit out of our actions are more of permit deny, but there is a QoS project which I'm not sure what if they've gone beyond limiting, but probably marking is in their roadmap. Yeah, so I think one thing is with DPI or any classification scheme, we hope that in Neutron we get to a point where you have a common way of classification. Mm-hmm. And that might be something that might feed into a QoS mark action or mm-hmm. a firewall action. I mean, yeah. Hopefully we'll kind of lead to that eventually. Mm-hmm. But today we are not there yet. We are not there.
Yeah, we want to do common classifiers later in, what's it, in O, so that's when we want to think more about marking.
uh, Is there some call to action for helping with this new API, especially when you're moving to ports and
this
zones?
This is the call to action.
That's the call to action, yeah.
So basically, you know, everybody has to start giving their use cases and beating up on that API, I think.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so I think one thing that we also should do, you know, is that, you know, I think we'll make sure that we kind of link all our Etherpads and all these things into our OpenStack FWaaS wiki. So so that way it'll be easy for you to, I mean, today it's everything is not linked in, but, you know, just give us a couple of days and then hopefully just a Google OpenStack FWaaS wiki will get you to the wiki page and we make sure that we kind of have everything linked in. Yeah. And, you know, you guys can
And we'll definitely start with the standard OpenStack browsers and write specs for all those things. We encourage on everybody to look through the specs, make sure that they can review them and everything.
Can you elaborate a bit more on the service groups? Because I'm thinking from a device terminology, it looks like address books and application sets.
Yeah, it's very much like an address group. The service group terminology is more to talk about, you know, to have a collection of, you know, protocol and ports, and you can, so instead of, I mean, the motivation for coming up with it, of course, this came up like about 3 cycles ago. The motivation was rather than having multiple rules, I mean, with the rules looking like, you know, source IP A to dest IP B, you know,
port 80,
port, and then again, source IP A, dest, you know, to, if you want to filter on a bunch of, you know, a protocol or port entities on two identical endpoints. This gives you a grouping mechanism so that, you know, you create one, you write one rule and that creates an indirection. So that's the whole idea with service groups.
Mm-hmm. Also have this documentation, you can call it like HTTP server and then you slap it on something and then you know has all the things for you.
Sets also may help, right? Like we want to same rule be to be applied in a bunch of ports or a bunch of application
The same rule, I mean, so now the way at least FWaaS is structured is that the policy is reusable. You can take a policy and apply it on different at you know, different points. The rule is bound to a policy, though.
Question: where the firewall function deployed in a network node? Or VM, or OVS, or DVR?
So I think that's one of the things that we want to solve here, in that today it's deployed only on the router, but we want to kind of make that change so that our binding is more with a Neutron port or a collection of ports. So then it could be on a router interface, it could be on a VM port as well. Now, OVS or, I mean, I think we kind of hinge on where. When it comes to VM ports today, you know, security groups are, you know, put in a Linux bridge sitting in front of your, you know, VM, and our implementation will probably go that route. But as German mentioned, if you look at OVN, OVN is trying to put security groups into OVS, and which means that, you know, if that happens in Neutron, so we will take that route as well.
Yeah, we want to be as pluggable as possible so that you could have an OVN driver, which then kind of takes our model, takes the stuff the user created for our API and kind of puts it into OVN. So that's why we want to be as flexible and as pluggable, because things always change and there's lots of technologies we want to support, but we want to be the API for them.
Yeah, and I think the other thing is we'd love to hear from users, and you know that would be the, you know, that was kind of one of the motivations for doing this, so that we can at least connect with some people that can help us drive some use cases, and you know.
Yeah, absolutely.
You mentioned scalability. Do you have some initial ideas whether it'd be better doing it on OVS or on a DVR versus on each VM, even when you go to port back?
It's still too early to know how we want to achieve the scalability goal. There are some things service groups did to get more scalable. We want to study that and understand how that all worked. But we want to first see how the implementation looks like, how we get to the ports, and how the agents look like we put out there. And then basically when we have that figured out, then work on scalability in more detail. Yeah.
call it a wrap.
All right. Thank you for attending.
Thank you.